Welcome, everybody, on this beautiful Tuesday night. I realize it's 75 degrees out, so thank you all for joining us. This is our final guest of the spring semester, believe it or not. We have a terrific guest. Dean King, as many of you know, because he's your dean, has joined us here, Dean Christopher King from the School of Health. But as we do every time, I'd like to go, everybody go around and just introduce yourself, what program you're in, and where you're from. Arjun, you want to start us?
Yeah, definitely. My name is Arjun Ryan. I'm a sophomore healthcare management policy major, and I'm originally from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Awesome.
I told you your people will be here tonight.
All right. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, I'm Maddie. I'm a global health major. I'm a sophomore. Yeah,
that's wonderful.
And I'm from London.
Wonderful. Nice to meet you.
Abby?
Hi, I'm Abby. I'm from New York, and I'm a sophomore in the School of Nursing.
Awesome. Nice to meet you, Abby.
And Abby's the first nurse we've had, first BSN we've had in our program. So this is
wonderful.
Awesome. Sylvie?
Wonderful.
Hi, I'm Sylvie. I'm a freshman in global health and school of health, and I'm from Philadelphia.
Nice to meet you.
Gia?
Hi, my name is Gia. I'm a senior in SFS majoring in international affairs and global health.
Wonderful. Nice to meet you, Gia. Nice to meet you, Ryan.
Hi, my name is Julia. I'm a junior in the School of Health and Global Health. I'm from
the Wonderful.
Hi, I'm Cheyenne, also a junior in the School of Health, also a junior in Global Health.
Awesome. Nice meeting you.
Hi, I'm Colin. I'm a freshman in the college majoring in biology, and I'm from outside of Seattle.
Wonderful. Nice to meet you.
I'm Madeline. I'm a freshman in the School of Health, human science major right now, and I'm studying. Oh, and I'm from Chicago.
Chicago.
It's a Chicago thing.
Chicago.
I didn't.
You not, already covered it, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
Hi, I'm Lily. I'm from the School of Health Studies, Global Health, and I'm from Arizona.
Ah, nice to meet you, Lily.
And my name's Ben. I'm a sophomore at the college studying government, and I'm from outside Chicago.
See, there's...
There we go. Yep.
I didn't set it up this way. It just turned out.
I love it.
So
love it.
We have a we have a great group, including many students in your school.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
So I think... So tonight, Dean King's going to be with us to tell us, as we do each week, about, you know, his career, about his life. And then we have four people who prepared briefing emails for tonight's class, so thank you all in advance for that. Dean King, this is where we usually start. So everybody here has read your bio and they know your history, but I thought we might start at the beginning. If you could give us a little bit of a sense of where you grew up and mm-hmm. when you think of what led you to where everybody is here today. As you know, well know, everybody here is an undergrad. They're trying to think of what to do with their lives.
Gosh.
And so if you could take us back to... Yeah. where you grew up and how you got to this place, that would be terrific. And at least get us to where you were when you got to college and what you were thinking about.
Sure.
We'll go from there.
First of all, thank you for this invitation. You have an amazing professor. Amazing professor. Thank you for your warm welcome. It's a pleasure to be here and share a little bit about my journey, and hopefully through the story and what I share with you will enlighten you and stimulate you and intellectually in ways that you haven't thought of at this point in your lives. So I was born in DC.
Yeah.
I'm one of the few that you'll meet. I am a DC native. I was born at DC General, which was a public hospital in the District of Columbia. And we moved to Kentucky when I was 3 years old. My grandfather was a coal miner, and my mom wanted to move and be with her parents. And so we moved to Kentucky. And lived there until seventh grade, and then we moved to North Carolina. I didn't hear anyone say Kentucky or North Carolina in the room, right? But we moved to North Carolina, and I call North Carolina home because I spent a lot of my formative years in North Carolina, or you know, growing into adulthood there. I went to undergrad at East Carolina University. I studied community health. And I also pursued an education track, which allowed me to graduate with what was necessary at that time to teach. So I was qualified to teach in the public school system right after graduation. My plan was to stay in North Carolina and pursue my master's immediately after my undergrad. And we had a recruiter from Prince George's County, which is right outside of DC, come to North Carolina, and they were looking for more black males to teach in the schools in Prince George's County. And I was at a crossroads, you know. It was like, do I stay at this one university and pursue my master's, because I had already applied and gotten into the master's program there, or do I take some time and go directly into the field and do some work? And I was really stressed out about that. I was like, what am I supposed to do? Please show me the way. I want to make the right decision. And I'll tell you what was thrown my way that really made me change my mind was the starving salary. In North Carolina,
very practical.
It was 1990. Practical. Wait, what year was this? This was 1991. Yeah, 1996. 1996. Starting salary for a first year teacher. How much do you think it was in North Carolina?
Take a guess. Just 50. Anybody
That's
else?
That's so 2023.
I know. Exactly. I can safely say you can go down from there. Any other guesses?
Yeah, 20,000. 20,000. And the recruiter from Prince George's County said, well, our starting pay is $30,000. And that was when I decided.
You decided it was time to see what Washington, D.C.
was
like.
When can I start?
Did they tell you it was more expensive?
Yeah, I didn't think about that. You know, it was just like. And so I taught high school health education. What you'll hear as I go through my journey is that everything I've done has been in health.
I know.
And I'm going to show you all a picture. I call them receipts.
Oh.
I'm going to show you a receipt of my first year teaching, and I taught health, right? Awesome. And to now be in this position is like major, major full circle moment for me. You know,
I had a small role in helping persuade Dean King to become Dean King, and it was so striking the first time we met, the point you just made, that you had always been a health educator, and this was the right person at the right time.
I sure did. I taught health, and I did some moonlighting. I was actually teaching CPR, so I was CPR instructor. That's one thing about my family. We would always find ways to make money. And so I taught CPR, started my own little company called Health Source, and did so well that a hospital reached out to me and said, we'd love for you to come and work for us full time. And I was like, okay, this is pretty cool. And I learned a lot on the job. I learned about organizational leadership, strategic management, healthcare. I was responsible for developing a new employee orientation program for our hospital to better align.
That was in
Prince George's County, Prince George's Hospital Center. Yeah. And I remember given this big responsibility to design a whole new orientation program for new employees, no matter what level or what type of work they did. So from folks who are cleaning in the bathrooms to folks who are providing surgical procedures, they all had to go through an orientation, a four-hour orientation. And I was responsible for that. And that work really did catapult me in my career. And I took on additional responsibilities at that hospital. And then had an opportunity to work for an FQHC. How many of you are familiar with FQHC? What does that stand for?
Any guess, Arjun?
Is it federally qualified health?
How do you know that, sir?
The great curriculum, the healthcare management policy.
Of course, of course, that's it, yes.
See, there you go.
There we go, yep.
See, it's working every day.
It's working every day. So if someone tells you there's no place for a person to go to get primary care, good primary care in this country if they're undocumented, you would say that is not a true statement, right? They're called FQHCs. FQHCs are amazing places that provide primary care services to persons no matter what their insurance status is or citizenship status, right? And so these are safe places where individuals can go, people can go to receive top-notch primary care, but not just primary care, but a social service, all kinds of wraparound services that we know are important for improving the health of an individual in a community. So I did work at an FQHC, and I was a director of programs there, and that's when I really, really connected the dots and said, my goodness, we can provide the best medical care. And in my lectures, I talk about we're providing medical care in this country. We haven't cracked the code on how to deliver health care. I'll come back to that in a minute. So we were delivering top-notch medical care, clinically, you know, we were following clinical guidelines, evidence-based medicine, we were doing all the right things, but we weren't seeing significant improvements in our patient populations. And that's when I realized, wow, this is health is much bigger than our ability to provide medical care, right? And so how do we think more holistically around improving the health outcomes of individuals and populations? What does that look like? And what is our responsibility as a healthcare delivery system, right? And that's when I realized public health is a very important competency if we want to be in the space of improving people's health. We have to have public health competencies, and we have to be on top of these new and emerging skills that are necessary in the workforce to improve health. I'll come back to that in just a moment too, right? So I did that, did a lot of writing. I was a grant writer. Mm-hmm. I had a gift of taking an issue and writing a compelling story that would be appealing to funders that want to support improving quality of care and access to the most vulnerable members of our society. And so I was able to do really well in securing some funding for, it was called Greater Baden Medical Services. It's the only FQHC in Southern Maryland. And I'll never forget this. One of my biggest accomplishments, and I know someone asked that question, was my first grant that I wrote by myself. And by the way, you're not supposed to do these things by yourself. You're supposed to do them with
good group
people.
Yep, that's right.
But I was really, really like, this is me. This is my work. I got to make this happen. It was a bicultural demonstration grant, and it was for $1 million. Again, this was my very first grant that I wrote, and it was funded. So what was that grant about? It was about increasing representation of Spanish-speaking populations and the care that we were providing, because we were seeing a significant growth in the Spanish-speaking populations in Southern Maryland, but they weren't coming in for care. And what I wrote was a plan for how would we increase the Spanish-speaking community, how would we make sure that that population has access and they come to our facilities and receive compassionate, caring, high-quality care. And how would we do that? We can't do this in a vacuum. We have to work in partnership with communities. And so in my proposal, there was a leader in the community of a grocery store. It was a Mexican grocery store called El Mercadita. And we partnered with the owner of that grocery store, well-respected man in the community, who, if he would say, come to this destination Saturdays at 6 o'clock, the community would show up, right? He was the one that led this program, this initiative. It wasn't me, it wasn't the clinicians, it was a community member that was very, very passionate about making sure that his patrons have access to the services that they need to be well. And so I'll talk a little bit about shifting power. Mm-hmm. That's an example of what that means. And being humble and recognizing I don't know all the answers. I have to work in partnership. We have to co-create with communities. Mm-hmm. And that's something, again, a new competence, something that some folks have been doing all their careers. But for the mass population, I think that this is something that's new that folks are really struggling with. How do you relinquish power mm-hmm. and co-create interventions with the community? Or how do you just let go and make sure that the community has resources to find its way, right? So we're seeing all kinds of different models in different communities where this is being done, which is really, really cool. So I did that work, and then MedStar Washington Hospital Center.
Right. Which is part of Georgetown Hospital.
Part of the MedStar, yep. They were looking for a grant writer. And I said, well, I'm more than a grant writer, because grant writers, they would think, well, here's a grant writer. I'm more of a strategist, right? And so what's the problem? And I can help the leadership strategize, and together we come up with a plan, and I can just document it, right? That was what I was doing for MedStar Washington Hospital Center, and was able to get some quite a bit of funding to support populations at MedStar Washington Hospital Center. Almost done. And then in 2010,
this is the reason we're here.
2010, guess what happened? What happened in 2010? HCMP, you know this? Land?
Affordable Care Act.
There you go. Well, all right. The Affordable Care Act, right? Legislation passed. Major, major accomplishment for this country. The Affordable Care Act is more than just Medicaid expansion. I always have to say that when I'm talking about the ACA, because folks think about, they're limited in thinking that it's just about ACA, I mean, Medicaid expansion, because that's what the press is constantly covering. There's a lot of legislation in the ACA that is making access to care easier for populations, improving the quality of care when people go in for services. There's a lot of that we have to do now in healthcare delivery to make sure that when patients come in, they leave better off than they were when they arrived, right? Making sure that services are safe and equitable. Anyway, there's a whole lot that we can talk about with the ACA and the benefits of it and improving the health of the nation. So MedStar, just like many other healthcare delivery systems, had to respond to a requirement in that legislation. And that is to conduct a community health needs assessment. Once every 3 years, every not-for-profit hospital has to conduct a community health needs assessment. Has anyone participated in a community health needs assessment process? What do you think it is?
Don't be shy.
And there, I mean, yeah, just jump in. Brain, where you can just whatever. What do you think? What it's pretty. Just community health needs assessment. They'll be intimidated by it. Yes. Okay. That's a piece of it. What else would you say? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So community health needs assessment is a comprehensive process in which you are identifying what are the health issues impacting this community, right? And for so long, community health needs assessments solely focus on like disease conditions. Well, people in this zip code are more likely to develop and or die from diabetes, and this zip code, high cholesterol is an issue. That's the old school way of conducting community health needs assessments. We know these things are true. They've been true for a long time. You have certain populations that are more likely to have certain types of comorbidities and premature mortality. We know this. The question is, why does it exist? So I call this CHNA Community Health Needs Assessment 2.0, right? We're really, really getting to the root cause of why we're seeing high rates of whatever the disease condition is. That also is part of the Community Health Needs Assessment, which requires us to have a much more broad lens. We have to think about the socioeconomic conditions of a community, because we know that a person's health or a community's health is mostly shaped by what's happening outside of the walls of medicine, right? And so hospitals, health systems needed executives who understand how to conduct community health needs assessment. What does that look like? How do you engage communities in this process? How do you partner with community-based organizations to do meaningful work? How do you measure progress longitudinally? These are expectations now of all hospitals that are not-for-profit. And so MedStar hired me to do that work for the system. And so I designed a CHNA framework. I wish I had hard copies. I have so many hard copies. And I'm always like, I look at these big boxes and I'm like, I could have brought them to you all. But no one likes paper anymore, so you probably wouldn't have liked me for having all the
paper. We could send you a link.
We could send you the link. But you just go to, or you could just Google MedStar Community Health Needs Assessment, and that is our work. And even though I'm not still there, I still support the work. And students also have an opportunity. If you're interested in being a part of this next round, we're recruiting students over the summer to begin in the fall, because we have to do it again next academic year, right? So our HCMP students have historically contributed to the CHNA for MedStar hospitals. So let me tell you this. So in 2010, I started that work, and I used the language social determinants of health. at a board meeting. And I remember some of the board members, and if anyone is in the MedStar system and you're watching me, I am not disparaging MedStar Health, okay? These are stories that were rampant across the healthcare sector. It wasn't just a MedStar thing. So I introduced the term social determinants of health to some of the leadership, and I got pushback. Social determinants of health, again, are those things outside of the medical institution that we know are key factors that influence health. So I knew what was coming with the ACA. I knew that values-based payment models, in other words, we're going to be paid based on our ability to keep people well. The whole fee-for-service model was trending out, and we're looking at new and emerging payment models that demonstrate, that reward us for keeping people well. And those institutions that do the best in that space will be the most fiscally sound, right? And so I would talk to folks, okay, preventing readmissions is a perfect example. Like CMS, they want to see that your institution is preventing readmissions. And if we're going to prevent readmissions, we have to ask patients questions about what does your home environment look like. We need to know what's going on at home, and we want to be sure that we have measures in place to support wellness at home, right? And so this is an example of thinking beyond medicine. This requires us to think about who do we partner with in the community to be sure that Mrs. Annie, when she's discharged from her heart failure treatment, when she's home, has access to what we know she needs to stay well. This, my friends, is healthcare, right? What we've been doing for a long time was just medical care. Here's another example. If a doctor prescribes a prescription, and the prescription needs to be taken on a full stomach, what we've done for so long is we just assume that people have food. We're not asking questions about food insecurity. And so we're seeing some health systems doing some excellent work. There's a hospital, a health system in Ohio, ProMedica Health System. They have a hospital and they have a food pantry on the premises. And if a patient has been diagnosed with food insecurity, diagnosis isn't the right word, If they've identified a patient who is experiencing food insecurity, they will write a prescription, not for medicine, but for food. And that patient can go to that food pantry on the premises, on that campus of that facility, of that healthcare facility, and get food because that medication needs to be taken on a full stomach. That, my friends, is healthcare. What we've been doing for so long, oh, just prescribe the medication and send them home. We're not thinking beyond that. And so that's work that has to be done if we're going to improve our healthcare delivery system. We're spending $4 trillion a year on healthcare. And when you break that down per capita, it's almost two times more than other industrialized countries. And our life expectancy is among the lowest. So we have some issues that we have to deal with in the United States. Right, and I'll tell you, my work has been more domestically focused, but I also have enough sense to realize that we are interdependent. We are a global society, and when one country is not doing well, we will all be impacted in some way, shape, or form. Climate change is a perfect teacher of that, right? So I did that for MedStar, and I got my doctorate in health systems administration from University of Maryland, College Park. And I was at a point where, okay, now what do I do with myself, right?
Did you know you wanted to go back to teaching at any point? Or was
you know, I was always...
Because your journey was...
I was always teaching.
Fair enough.
As an adjunct. I taught at a community college level before I got here. I taught at University of Maryland as an adjunct. That's another consistent theme in my career. I've always been teaching, and I've always been teaching in the health space.
Not surprising.
So what was the straw that broke the camel's back when I was at MedStar? The social determinants of health, that was, that to me was, oh my gosh, I got a long way to go to get folks to think differently around how we organize and what does success look like. But I got to a point where I was ready to also talk about systemic racism as a root cause of health disparities, particularly in of course, people of color. And the system wasn't ready for me. This was in 2015. I was ready to do the heavy lift and help facilitate conversations that needed to be had at the highest levels of leadership. And the folks just weren't ready. Again, this was not unique to MedStar. This was industry-wide. Folks were just not ready to have that conversation. And you know, I got to a point where I was like, okay, that's what I need right now in my life. That's gonna be purposeful for me because I know that it's a root cause and I need to be in a space where I have intellectual liberty to have these conversations and use my voice and my research and scholarship in a meaningful way. And so I gave my notice. I didn't have another job lined up or anything. I don't know if you know this. I didn't know what I was gonna do. I just knew that I was at a turning point in my life, and I really believe in a purpose-driven existence. We all have purpose. And we go through different iterations of that, many of us throughout the course of our lives. And for me, it was, okay, I have to do something different. And it needs to be in this space because I am really, really exhausted with talking about health disparities and folks not really having real conversations that we need to have as a country, as a world. So I was gonna take a year and write about it. I was gonna write about what are the new and emerging skill sets that are needed in the healthcare workforce to address this issue. I was gonna travel. I'd been working all my life. Remember, I was doing CPR training, so I always had like side gigs, and I was always,
You could have supported yourself for a year.
I was able to support myself for a year, and Georgetown reached out to me and said, "Hey, Christopher." And the rest is history.
Just work out.
The rest is history. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And but this is your first time full time in higher education as a faculty. So that's a big transition from being in a leadership role in a very large, complicated health system to a faculty role and then a leadership role, of course, in your department and now in the school. Just maybe a few minutes on that transition.
I'm very thankful for that experience that I had in the field, that administrative experience, that leadership experience in a complex healthcare delivery system. It allowed me to be much more impactful in the classroom because I could bring real life experiences into the classroom and I had connections that I would not have had if I was always in academia. And so, I'm thankful for that. I think that my background in leadership and administration also helps me as a administrator in academia. Academia is a very different ball game, but you know, there's some things that are consistent, you know, doing a budget, right?
Sure.
It's been wonderful, this journey. I am just blessed to be in this space and to, you know, take us to a whole new level. I mean, the world is changing very rapidly. And I consider myself a futurist, like a strategist. Like we have to constantly critique how we're doing our work, how we're teaching, what we're teaching, and we need to be sure that it's relevant. We know that students want applied experiences in the classroom. They want to do work that can make a difference in real time. They don't want to just write a paper and it's not meaningful, right? And so it's time for us to catch up. In some spaces it's being done, but I do think that as an institution, it's not unique to Georgetown. We have some growth to do. I'm thinking about like AI.
Yep.
I mean, I went to a conference and some educators were just like, AI, I don't want to see it in the classroom. And I'm like, guys, It's here. It's here. It is our responsibility to take it in and think about how can we use it to advance knowledge, right? And so we can't be resistant to change. If we're resistant to change, I'm not confident that education is the right role for a person right now, because everything's changing so rapidly. And so I bring that lens as a dean, and I'm constantly thinking about how do we do our work differently? What are the new types of degree programs we need to offer? I love to see a degree at the intersection of artificial intelligence and health as a means of eradicating inequitable care. Oh, yes.
There's huge right? possibilities.
I mean, no. for real. There's a place for AI in helping us in our mission to make sure that everyone receives high-quality care that's not biased. I think there's a place for that. But it can also do harm, right? And that's why I say we have to embrace it. We have to get on top of it and not let it take control of us, because I feel like that could happen if we don't put some and there's regulatory issues that we need to address. I mean, it's just happening so fast that regulation can't keep up. And so what does that mean for us? And that's something I'm keeping my eye on.
Well, and yeah. I think for AI, the thing I've observed in my whole life is that technology is a given.
Yeah.
It will happen. It's not going away.
The real question is, can we have a public discussion
about what technology can be used for, both good and bad? And I think if educational institutions that want to be and have a public purpose, if we're not having that conversation, I can assure you other people will have it. So you all have a huge challenge ahead of you, and as we start to think about the ways in which technology is going to shape this field.
Yeah.
So before, as we typically will now go to the four students who start us off with the four students, and we'll open it up to everybody. But before we go, I do want to ask you one more question, which is about race. And is one of the papers that you all read, the Health Affairs piece, which is about the role of race, structural racism in the history of Washington, D.C., I do believe it should be required reading for anybody who does health policy work and lives in this city. You might be writing about Medicare in California or whatever, but if you live and work here, you need to understand things didn't end up the way they did here by accident. But you said something earlier that I'd love for you to elaborate on. You got tired of talking about health disparities, and you wanted to talk about race and social determinants of health. If you could elaborate on why disparities only get us so far, and why we have to look forward to look at social determinants and particularly systemic racism.
But
what is insufficient
about just looking at the numbers, so to speak, and how do you see the social determinants frame is the one that's more, that could lead us where we need to go.
Yeah. So let me just, I'd be remiss not to get on my race soapbox for a second.
That's why I asked.
So you all know that race is a social construct. It's rooted in an 18th century classification system, right? But for so long, you know, it's been a factor that's been used, or an indicator that's been used, to drive clinical decision making. So if you see language like race-based medicine or racism in healthcare, that's what I'm talking about, right? We know that these social and environmental conditions that are shaping our health. COVID, again, is a perfect example, right? Even in DC, it's like 3 out of 4 of persons who lost their lives to COVID are Black, and many of them are concentrated in specific parts of the city. It's not because of their Blackness that has caused them to develop or die from COVID. It's the conditions. And we have to unlearn that, right? Medicine has to unlearn that. That's one of the first questions they ask. What's your race, right? And people are hesitant to check that box for the reason that I just shared with you. What are you gonna, so because I check yes, you're going to assume this about me? Right. So we have to unlearn that, recognize race as a social construct, and when we collect data by race, let's be sure that we're not doing harm. I always say race, I wanna get to a point where we're not even talking about race. Because it's a social construct, right? I want to talk about these social determinants that we know drive health or poor health, right? And so if we focus on that, then perhaps that's a means of closing that gap in disparities that we see. So I've been in, even there's a publication that was in the New England Journal of Medicine where they were, again, research peer review publication, and they were suggesting that race was the cause of high COVID mortality, and they were on an apology tour for a long time because folks realized that this is happening. We've always known it, but after the death of George Floyd, folks are much more aware of these dynamics and the harm that they have and play in our lives. And I always say, this is something that affects us all. So if you're not representing a specific group, don't think that you can't be impacted. Again, COVID was a great example of that, right? You can't have this community having high rates of COVID. You live over here in your affluent bubble, so you think. People from this community are likely to provide service in this community. Right, and so we're all in this together. We're all in this together. So I hope that answered the question around the social determinants.
I just think sometimes, in my experience at least,
the terms like health disparities kind of get lumped into this larger reality, which you know we have systemic racism in this country. That's not news. I mean, to most people, but I think you're disaggregating. Yeah. The concepts. Yeah. It's really important because it leads, in my mind at least, to an urgency around the determinants agenda, right?
Yeah.
Because it otherwise we'll spend all of our time trying to change the dial on some levels of clinical care in systems that are themselves limited to how much they can achieve the change that we need.
Right.
Because you have to have the harder conversation, which is how we're living together.
Right. And you know, disparities are, what's the difference between a disparity and an inequity? This comes up quite a bit. So remember, a disparity is just a measurable difference when you're comparing comparable population. You can measure the difference, right? Higher rates of infant mortality in this particular group versus, that's a disparity. What causes a disparity? An inequitable condition. What does that mean? When you have one population that has more access to opportunity, whether it be education, whether it's housing, you know, they have more access to opportunity. And so when you have two populations where there's a difference, you're gonna see differences in health outcomes across those populations, right? I remember being on a panel and it was four of us and one person in the audience said, after listening to us for about an hour, one person in the audience said, if you had a magic wand to eradicate health disparities, what would you do? I'm going to ask you all that question before I tell you what my response was.
Any guesses?
This is a more interactive session than we typically have, but I think you got to run with it. Who wants to jump in?
Well, you said that inequitable conditions cause disparities. So mm-hmm. You've probably given them all inequities, right?
Okay, I like that.
Anybody else want to jump in?
Okay.
Quieter than usual. I don't know why. Anybody? It's good.
Okay. So we had one person say, well, we need more persons in the healthcare workforce. We need more doctors, more nurses. Someone else said, I said, let's give every child access to a high-quality education. The evidence is clear, right? The correlation between level of education and health outcomes is it's strikingly clear. And so if we could just commit to that, we'd be a better world. Give every person access to a high quality education.
Now we're going to switch it around. So you've been asking questions, which we typically don't do, but I love that. That's a great idea for the future.
Sorry, I kind of...
Arjun, no, this is great. Arjun, do you want to start us off? And then we'll...
Definitely. So first of all, Dean King, thank you so much for coming in. I've really enjoyed this conversation, kind of learning about your path in the healthcare field. And something that really resonated with me is how you discuss innovation and its role in healthcare, not only in technology, but also in terms of things like payment models and in the post-ACA period. And as you mentioned, as we enter kind of that post-pandemic era where we have a lot more renewed focus on social determinants, what kind of innovations do you see, technology or otherwise, that could be leveraged towards solving issues related to social determinants and really eliminating those health disparities?
Yeah, so there's several ways I can answer that question. One is, we have these wonderful community-based organizations that do outstanding work, and I'm gonna lift up Food and Friends. Food and Friends provides medically tailored meals to patients who are homebound. So patients with HIV, with cancer, they need medically tailored meals delivered to their homes. Okay, again, social determinant, right? That's what this organization does. So it's not just a random meal, it's medically tailored. Three meals a day. It's a not-for-profit. How do you think they stay open? How do they pay their bills? Philanthropy, donors, right? Giving them money, they write grants. And so the question, and we're seeing this now with some Medicaid products in which organizations like Food and Friends are reimbursed for the services that they provide. And they're being recognized as a key agent on the continuum when it comes to improving or delivering healthcare. So we're seeing some models like that. We're seeing interesting ways that technology can be used to increase folks' access to services in communities that it used to be called Aunt Bertha. I think there's another name for it now. But if you Google Aunt Bertha, it'll take you to the website. But you can put in a zip code. And you put in that zip code, and it gives you all kinds of resources based on these different tabs. Is it food? Is it utility assistance? Is it law? You need legal support. All these different things that we know are important for a person to stay well. You click on it, and it gives you like access to resources that you can take advantage of in real time. And so we're seeing that, which is really, really exciting. We're seeing devices where you know, consumers have more access to their health information, and they can monitor different, you know, biomedical parts of their anatomy, right? So you can see what you can track what's normal, what's not normal for you. So there's lots of innovation, but I'll tell you one thing: the regulatory ecosystem that we operate in a lot of times doesn't allow some of these really, really cool digital devices to go to scale. And that's something that we have to work through, like HIPAA. There's sometimes some constraints when it comes to HIPAA. And then just trust. Like, a lot of folks just don't want to disclose certain things or put their data in a device because they don't know what's going to be done with it. And so if we can get to a place where we have systems in place to protect people's personal health information, and the public will trust that, we can see some really, really cool, innovative technology entering the marketplace. But it's the regulations, and it's the trust and the fear of folks doing harm that's impacting people's ability to trust all these wonderful new things that we can use to have more control of our own, or be empowered to manage our health.
Excellent. No, and so how about Ben?
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. The microphone. It'd be great if you guys could. Thank you. And then after Ben, Lily.
Again, thank you so much for being here and giving us your time. This is kind of an open-ended question, but I was just wondering what career accomplishment are you most proud of? And what internal or external factors do you think were helpful in helping you achieve this goal?
I think that what I'm most proud of, and this is probably not going to be something you expect, is the young folks that I've been able to inspire and educate and help them kind of find their way to do work that's aligned with everything I've been talking about over the past 45 minutes. It's so personally gratifying when I get, and these things happen to us, like as educators, we get a random card or a random email saying, hey, I just want to say thank you, I just got this promotion, or there was something you did in the classroom that I just used this and it got me the job, or you know, or just this is my baby. Me and my husband and wife just had a baby. You know, knowing that I'm on their radar and they take time to acknowledge me and the role that I've played, the small role that I've played, is it makes me really proud. And to see our students go out into the world and do meaningful work that's in line with their personal mission and their life's passion, that makes me extremely, extremely proud. I'm also proud of this role. You know, this is a big deal. And I didn't imagine that I would be dean of a school when I left MedStar. I didn't know what, I knew something big was in store for me, I just didn't know what it would be. But to be here with you is just so rewarding to me. And to have all of you like making eye contact and you're a captive audience, and I can see how you're just taking all this in and processing it, that means the world to me. So,
That's why we were so thrilled that you agreed to be dean.
Yeah.
Because it's the right vision. So Lily?
Thank you so much for coming to speak with us. My question was, what do you think the role of Americans can or should be when it comes to imparting global health change in like the political and social structures of other countries when there is the risk of like ethnocentric behavior?
So your question really made me stop and think. I do think that we have a role to play, but I do think that we need to enter that space with humility, and we need to avoid ethnocentrism. Right, and I think I was talking earlier about relinquishing power. And as Americans, I think it's been just ingrained in us that we are this all the way up here. And it's been implicit and implicit in our minds, right, these messages. I do think that we have a very important role to play. And I think that what we have to do is find some of the most common denominator. What's the common denominator? I think climate change is one of those opportunities for us. This is something that we are, if you're human on this globe, we all have to realize, and I think, unfortunately, that's what's going to pull us together. I hate to say that, but I think that that is what's going to pull us together. So I think if we can use that as an example for how we can use our voice, our resources, our prestige as a country to support other countries, I think that's one way that we can do it. But I like your question. I think that we have to always go into any type of conversations with other countries with respect for their culture, their identity, and be humble and be willing to listen and learn.
Yeah. I just add, I think it's really critical what Dean King just said. I think one of the things I love the most about the School of Health under his leadership is that when we're thinking globally, I like to think it's horizontal learning and exchange. We aren't telling people what to do or importing what we're doing. Well, frankly, importing our system to someone else doesn't make much sense, right? But even if it did, it would be wrong, right? Because we're here to share what we know and to learn, even more importantly, what other people know. And that's the vision.
That's a powerful vision, and we can be, if we have the cultural humility you suggested, we could be really influential in the world.
And there's a lot we can learn. from countries that have been suffering.
Absolutely.
There's a lot that we can learn. There's a lot, like with the resilience, the all of the research around resiliency and how do you rebound, and when we're faced with some of the most difficult issues, go to countries that have been dealing with this for a long time. I mean, there's so much that we can learn. So it's not only what role can we play in affecting change, but what role can they play in helping us? Because we're not perfect, you know. We have our. I was reading a wonderful paper, and they were talking about our founding values and how some of the founding values of the country, the United States, really hurt us. Like individualism versus community, right? In the U.S., it's about me and my protection and my rights and my versus an orientation around the good, for the common good, right? That's an American like value. Me. I deserve this. My rights. And that has hurt us. This is my personal opinion for all the people in the world who are listening. I feel like that's hurt us because our orientation has not been around common good. It's around self-preservation and my rights. But instead, I'm always thinking about what's best for everyone and how do we make decisions to support a world where everyone can thrive.
Perfect time to turn this. Ryan, I think you.
Okay, yes. Oh, that'd be great. Thank you.
Hi, yes.
Ryan.
My question is more about healthcare in the DC area.
Yeah,
you talked
yeah.
a lot about it in the articles that we read. So my question is, like, are you optimistic for the future of healthcare in our city? Or, like, what's one thing that you see going on right now that we should be aware of?
I'm an optimist. So yes, I am optimistic. How long it's going to take? I'm an optimist who's rooted in reality. Right. How long is it going to take is the question. We're seeing things in the city that make me very, very nervous. Right. We're seeing gentrification, we're seeing housing costs, like it's just unaffordable for people. Folks are being pushed out. So there are things happening that will exacerbate disparities in this city. But on the other hand, there's things that are happening that are really good. Like the healthcare delivery system is maturing. I think we have one of the most progressive healthcare systems in the country. I mean, we are a progressive city. Mm-hmm. And so we have, when it comes to risk tolerance and trying new things, we're okay in that space. I mean, when I travel and I see what's happening in other parts of the world, I'm like, get me back to D.C., you know. But I do think that it's going to take some time, and I know that the mayor has done some great work. There's the Office of Racial Equity. There's a whole housing plan around affordable housing. There's work that's being done to counter what we're seeing, but I think it's going to take some time, but I think that's why I'm here. That's why you're here. I hope that you'll do some work while you're here in the city, whether it's an internship or volunteering to help address some of these issues.
So let me open it up to see some hands. Well, why don't we just start down here since everybody on this side, and then we'll go back up. So Gia?
Yeah, so earlier in your talk, you mentioned about how there is people like that are reluctant to go on board with the idea of social determinants. I was just wondering, what are like the key like points of pushback that they have? Like, what are the barriers to?
Yeah, so that conversation was, we're a hospital. Our mission is to take care of people when they come in and send them home. That was the narrative. We don't have the resources. We don't have the capacity to do work in the community, right? And so I get it. I mean, I understand the business of healthcare. I understand that we have to generate profit if we're going to pay people well, if we're going to reinvest in our services and infrastructure and technology and all those wonderful things. I get that. But I also recognize that we have to be creative too. And so we call these, a hospital is an anchor institution. Does that term ring a bell, anchor institution? an anchor institution is a big player in a community, like a hospital, like a university,
yep.
right? Anchor institutions are economic drivers in communities. They hire a lot of people. They rely on purchasing and procuring services to accomplish their mission. So as an anchor institution, you can have a social accountability lens in how you operate your enterprise. It's like hiring locally. It's like when you're ordering coffee and lunch, you're not going to Starbucks, you're going to a small private business in the community that's historically marginalized, and you have a contract with that particular vendor. Right. It's things like that that can be done to uplift and improve communities. And so that's what I would tell folks when they push back at me. We're not asking you to change the world. We're asking you to think about your business model and invest locally. And through those investments, we can uplift a community.
Hi, thank you for speaking with us. My question is kind of a continuation of that, but you mentioned a couple of different examples of ways that you've seen like successful programs to treat a person as a whole, or like for healthcare rather than medical care. And we've had some other conversations in this class with other guest speakers who come from like community health organizations or clinics.
Yeah, Gomez was here.
Oh, good. Oh, yeah, yeah.
So like, for example, that organization relies a lot on their trust that they build in the community. Yeah, yeah. And I think I can imagine that it's harder for hospitals to build that kind of trust because it's such a big institution. Mm-hmm. So like, how would you recommend kind of partnership between those smaller institutions that are more well-known and more trusted and larger kind of institutions rather than organizations to make sure that like the whole person is treated?
Yeah. So that's definitely in my wheelhouse. So I work with boards of hospitals that are grappling with this question. And one of the things that we have to do, or what they have to do, is again shift the power. And I'm going to give you another example in just a second of how you do that. Shift the power. Make sure you have a workforce that is representative of the population. Make sure you have senior leadership that is racially, ethnically, whatever the demographics of that, there needs to be some consistency there, an alignment. And think about the language that we're using. Like, for example, we say, I told the president of a hospital said, we're going to adopt a local not-for-profit. No, we don't use that language. What's wrong with that? We're going to adopt a not-for-profit. What type of message does that convey? We're going to adopt a...
I feel like it implies like ownership.
Yeah, yeah. So it's again, the power dynamic is in that message. And so I would say, no, don't say that. See, these are when I say the competencies that we need, this is an example. Language matters, the narrative matters. And so instead of we're going to adopt, we're going to co-create with the community, right? And so it's those types of exercises and learning or unlearning that needs to happen with these big players in the market, because they for so long they've operated and they've been respected as, oh, you're the big hospital, you have all the answers, and I think they're realizing now that they can't, that's not how the future is going to be if they're going to be successful. So it's the language that's being used, it's making sure you have a workforce, it's owning up to your flaws and the mistakes that you've made in the past. We've done some work with hospitals that are doing racial equity audits, where they're looking at the history of their institution, like we're doing at Georgetown.
I was gonna say, this is an institution.
And they're looking at names of buildings, and they're like, who was this person? Was this a good actor in the 1700s or 1800s or what? or was this a bad actor, right? And they're grappling with that. Like, what do we do with that, right? So atonement, I call this atonement and policy and practice. Those types of initiatives are also part of what needs to be done to bridge that gap. And taking ownership, you know, COVID, again, distrust came up quite a bit, right? People have trust issues with the healthcare delivery system. And I have one patient at a community health needs assessment. She says, Christopher, I trust my doctor. I don't trust the institution. I don't trust the institution and what's done with my information. That's my issue with healthcare. Her position is justified if we know the history, we understand her and her position. The question is, what are we going to do as institutions to address that? Right? So being transparent, listening, and conducting audits of where your institution has dropped the ball historically, owning up to that. Because these stories have been told from generation to generation. I mean, I'm from DC. There are stories about certain hospitals and institutions in DC that have been passed down for generations, and people just don't trust that particular entity. So, yeah. Did that answer your question?
Yes,
thank
you.
Did I just go above and beyond your question?
No, it was great.
Thanks, Sylvie. Abby, were you? I'm sorry. I think everyone had their hand up. Okay, yeah. Go ahead. Go ahead, Abby.
Okay, so as a student in the School of Nursing, with the recent split between the School of Nursing and the School of Health, I'm really interested to hear about, you know, what your thoughts are on how we can still collaborate between those schools, because healthcare really is involving all people, you know, the policymakers, the nurses, doctors, everyone involved. Do you have ideas?
Abby, right?
Yes, Abby.
That's a wonderful question, and that is more work that we have to do, right? So we know that the School of Health will be rooted in interdisciplinary. Everything we do, we have to think about having med students, nursing students, health admin students, and other students from other degrees, having shared experiences in the classroom, learning from each other, understanding different disciplines, solving problems together, because that's where innovation occurs when you have all these different folks with different perspectives challenged with one issue, and together they can really do some interesting work in improving or coming up with a solution. So that's work that Dean Jones, who's with the School of Medicine, and myself and other deans are thinking about. It's like, how do we again conduct a critical audit of how the classroom has looked historically at Georgetown in these health roles, these health courses, and how do we totally turn things upside down and not work in silos or in these department-specific methods. So we have the just because we have decoupled doesn't mean that we're going to go further away from each other. We actually see it as an opportunity to deepen our collaborative efforts. And so there's more to come with that. But, for example, we're thinking about with the nursing program. What if we have a nursing student who wants to go into leadership and administration? Well, we have that in healthcare management and policy. So why can't a nursing student take some of our courses and get either a certificate or a master's degree for if they stay in that additional year? We're looking at different types of degree pathways so that you have a much more diversified experience, and you have different types of degrees or certifications when you graduate or when you leave the hilltop. So that's work that we're doing. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Abby?
Oh yeah, my question kind of followed from Abby's question. I was just wondering what one of the biggest challenges was when you came to the School of Health, and like, where do you see it progressing?
I think the biggest challenge, and I don't think this is something that really you all have to be concerned with as students, but I do think it's a teachable moment. The nursing was around, 1903, right?
Yeah,
that's a long time. What's your name again?
Maddie.
Maddie?
Yeah.
Maddie, 1903, right? it's 2022 when this all transpired, where there's a decision made to decouple this unit that has how many years is that? Well, that's like a lot of years, right? All those years.
120 years with the school of nursing and then together with the health departments for other 20
some. So over 100 years, right? And now we're going to totally interrupt that. That's organizational change. And when you have organizational change that radical, everyone's not going to be on the same, everyone's not going to agree with the decision. And so my challenge has been for folks who had a difficult time with that, and it could be also be students, not just faculty, but it could be students, staff, alums, who are like, you can't do this. And so my challenge has been to listen to people and it's okay, and hear them and empathize with them, but also to display leadership that shows that the plane has taken off, right? And we're moving forward. And are you going to be on or are you going to jump off, right? This is very routine, natural, a normal part of organizational change. And so that's a leadership skill that I've had to, you know, I've had to really, really hone in this transition. And so that's one. And the other is just, it's a new school. It's very challenging. It's legacy work. And I want to be sure that, you know, that we leave our mark. This is a very special moment in the history of Georgetown. And I just want to be sure that all of us do something very, very amazing together. Yeah.
You will. Yeah. But it is, I do think organizational change is important. Yeah. It's kind of, especially for those of you who are in the School of Nursing and the School of Health. You're here for something that we do. I don't know. We created the McCourt School 12 years or 15 years ago now. I mean, new schools come about every 50 years or so, and we've never done two new schools at the same time. So you're really here for a moment of creation. Yeah. That's really exciting. So I'm going to switch now to the other side. So let's see who else. Who had their hand up over here? I can't remember. Did everybody? I can't remember. Please.
Hi. I was wondering if during your time with MedStar or anything, you worked on like the social determinants of like mental health and how you saw that as being different from addressing the social determinants of physical health.
Yeah. Thanks for asking that. I'm ashamed that I've been talking for about a little over an hour. We haven't talked about mental health because that is very important. And what we have to do is we have to integrate behavioral health and primary care, right? It needs to be normalized. It needs to be appreciated equally as the physical part of caring for people. And so, yes, I did do quite a bit of work around integrating, behavioral health screenings in primary care settings. Now, the challenge that we had, and this is, again, not unique to the space that I was in, but sometimes providers don't want to know the answers to these questions because we don't have the capacity to meet the need, which puts them in a very moral, ethical dilemma. That was a very interesting lesson learned and observation for me. It's like, you know, I remember we rolled out the behavioral screening tool, and we had some providers who said, you know, I don't want to ask these questions because what if the patient checks the box and it's yes? We don't even have anyone within the zip code who can deliver the service that this patient needs. You know? So that's an issue, and it still is. So behavioral health and mental health experts are needed, and they need to be perceived as just as important as folks who are doing work around physiology and the physical part of our existence. Yeah.
Do you have a question?
So I'm actually a tour guide with Blue and Gray. Just before this class, we actually had a workshop with the Racial Justice Institute. And
Rosemary.
And she mentioned how the Racial Justice Institute was really hoping to partner with the School of Health in the near future and integrate or you know, co-creates really unique and awesome programs, but she didn't really get to expand much. And I was just curious if you could touch on maybe future collaborations with the Racial Justice Institute. Or
I would love to see a master's degree in, again, at the intersection of racial equity and health, or race and health. I think that's something that Professor Griffith would really love. But I see us offering new degrees in that space. I also see the Racial Justice Institute in helping us vet our curriculum and helping us develop really interesting case studies that provide very different narratives and critiquing us, right? And giving us feedback on our performance as a school. We also want to be sure that we're asking our students about their experiences in the classroom. I think the Racial Justice Institute can help us with that, with a sense of belonging and feeling that their lived experiences are represented, or folks from their community, those experiences are represented in the classroom. That's work that we have to do. We have to do much better at that, because if people come to classes and they have a whole 4 years of experience at Georgetown and they never had an experience in the classroom that really resonated with them and their community, whether it be religion, race, ability or disability, that's a problem, right? And so we always need to audit ourselves and make sure that we're creating spaces where all people see themselves represented in different spaces. And that needs to be across our university campus. And I think that that's something that the RJI can facilitate and should be facilitating.
And I'm sure will be.
And health is, is, and there's a reason why health was one of the three priorities in its creation. Yeah. So.
And Alina, I couldn't tell if you had your hand up or not.
I got a question.
Okay. Oh, I knew it. Please.
One more question.
Sure.
So I'm from Chicago, and I did some shadowing over the summer at a clinic at the University of Chicago, which is, and I got to experience a lot firsthand of the differences in some of the hospital systems I'm more familiar with on the north side versus some of the hospital systems on the south side. Mm-hmm. And a big topic of conversation was how a lot of the healthcare disparity that we saw firsthand was a result of generations and generations of injustice.
Yeah.
It went far beyond the medical field. And I know in this class in particular, we've had several people who are active in politics come to speak to us. And so I was just curious, as someone who's grown up in DC and has continued to work here, how have you worked with the government or some legislative bodies in your work in the healthcare field, or if you haven't personally, how can they have a symbiotic relationship?
Yeah. I think, well, yes. We actually do a community health needs assessment for the city. We're looking at racial disparities. And this is work that we do for the mayor's office. And so we do this once every 4 years that we do this. So we're not only looking at, again, the physical issues or the diseases or types of illnesses people are experiencing, we're looking at socioeconomic disparities. And it's a short report, you can Google it. And the whole purpose of this is for policymakers. I remember they asked us to do, your name again?
Madeline.
I remember they asked us to do this. It was government officials, and they said, we need a report. Tell us about health disparities. We want to be sure that policymakers are informed. And they wanted like a 1,000-page academic report. And I said, well, who's the audience? Again, students were in the room. They were part of this whole conversation. It was a wonderful teachable moment. I asked the government officials, who's the audience? And they said, it's for policymakers. And I said, so you want us to do a 1,000-page academic assessment for policymakers? And they were like, yes. I was like, who's going to read it? Right? And so I was able to convince them to condense it down to something that was very easily digestible and people could process and would have language that would they could easily recite in other spaces, right? And so that's what we do. We create this disparities report for the District of Columbia, designed for policymakers. So that's one way. The other way that I do it, I serve on the DC Mayor's Commission on Health Equity. And so I'm able to use my voice with other commissioners to look at different policies and practices in DC and to determine if they are equitable or if they cause even more harm, right? And so that's what I do. And anytime I have the opportunity, I bring students along the journey so they can experience it.
So. Anybody else? Well, I can't think of a better way to finish up our semester. So
thank you.
Dean Kane,